Okay, the coffee is ready for you, so let's start. Before we dive into the C4 High Explosive Dangerous Continuous Culture Change Challenges, I would like to say thank you to Alexander, who is sharing the stage with me today. He's a friend and colleague from the development team, and we are working both together in the STRAVAG for the infrastructure and the software development department, and of course for the operations. Last year, as I was here on the stage, I talked about Docker and Ops Unleashed, where I told you something about how we managed it to get from a very old and very hard deployment model to a new one, to a continuous integration and continuous deployment model. And this year, we would like to talk a little bit about how we did a cultural change, because as we think, a change to DevOps or SRE or whatever you would like to call it is only possible if you just look at the culture. As Björn said it before, culture can be complicated. I would like to say not complicated, but culture can be complex, because you're working with people and we are all different and we have all different thoughts about the things, and there you have to put in some kind of communication. So we're going to not to talk about technology as such and Kubernetes and service meshes, proxies, and I don't know whatever there is else. This is technology, and technology is manageable in our opinion, because it's something you can learn, you can discover, but it's not easy to achieve the goal that you have to work together. And even if you are ops and developers in different teams or in your company, then it's even more interesting to see how this can be going on. Our talk is split up in four parts. The first is startup, where we were coming from. The second part is the way, where we would like to just show you some thoughts about how we managed it to come from a very traditional, from a very traditional point of view, how we develop the things and how we operate the things. Then we will go on to the life. That's more or less how we are working today. And then we will cover something about the future. So maybe there is something inside there where we see the challenges in the future. But first of all, just some words about us. My name is Mario Kleinsesser. I am working at the STRAVAG company in Austria in an IT department. We have a large IT department. I am the team leader of, now we call us Cloud Solution Architects, because we use different types of services, on-premises, cloud services, Docker, and so on and so on. And we just, for your information, last year as I was here, I told the audience that we were running about 400 containers, something like that. And now, 1 year later, we have 150 stacks with about 400 services and 1,800 containers running in production. The effort was mainly made by the colleagues from the development department, who were really keen to step into also the operations, and also from my team, because we have to know how we can work together and how we can just make things possible that weren't possible before. Alex.
Yeah, my name is Alex. It's the first talk at the conference here, so I'm a little bit nervous, so sorry for that. And I will try my best. So I'm a team leader of the software development department. At my team, we are 7 people who do stuff for STRAVAG. So we are creating, constructing software for our operational and commercial units. And it's always quite challenging to talk to our operation guys and so on, but that's daily life. And yeah, in the past, we have several problems. For example, we had our development stack. We cannot, we can't use new technologies. Because of that, we come later to it. But nowadays, we are proud to say that we can use multi-cloud setups, or for example, our on-premises Docker Swarm clusters. And with this use of these things, we are able to fulfill more or less nearly all the requirements of our customers. So I think we can start to our first challenge.
Yes, we come to our first challenge in the startup where we were about 2 years ago, and I think this comic taken from DeviantArt is a really good picture and cool mindset, because it roughly means how we worked before we make the cultural change. Because just imagine that John in this picture, who is defusing bombs, are the operators, and in the ear, in the voice, that he hears, he get an information from the developers and said, yeah, I will cut just the line because I have to restart the server, for example. And he takes the wire cutter, put it on, and cut it through, and everything was okay, definitely okay, afterwards. Because nobody of them, neither John, who is the diffusing guy, has told the development that he is colorblind, for example. So they haven't communicated, and both of the teams thought about that the other team has the absolute knowledge what they would like to have. So in our opinion, it was a totally blindfolded work, because the development guys just dropped the software over the wall, and the operation guys, like I am, just took it, installed it on a server where the development guys doesn't even know what this is. Yeah, is this a Linux server, for example, or something in between? And then this was really every day a challenge, because nobody knows what's going on in the background, and even we from the operations department have no idea what the colleagues from the development department have the need of tools or databases, or what they need to come a step forward. So for us, it points out that it's mostly a communication problem, because the tooling around, and if you talk about DevOps, for example, everywhere is standing DevOps on the folders and slides and so on, yeah, and it's often compared with tooling, yeah, but it's mainly it's a simple communication problem. And there's one quote from Konrad Lorenz. I don't know who knows him, and I've translated it to English, but I don't know if I get it correct. What is thought is not yet said. What is said is not yet understood. What is understood is not yet accepted. What is accepted is not yet applied. And what is applied is not yet kept. So in every stage of your work together, you have the challenge that you have to be sure that the people who are talking to are in the position that you can, that they understand you, what you need and what you're in need of, especially in a relatively complex environment. And that's the point where the second challenge comes into.
Yeah, there are two words which sum up our work together in the past. So, for example, I'm a motivated young software engineer. There comes our customers and say, yeah, we want to have full-text search. Okay, you say, no problem. There are tools available outside the market, for example, Elasticsearch. Then with this idea, you go to our operations department and say, hey, guys, I need Elasticsearch. I want to have servers for that. I want to use it. And the operation guy said, ah, that's quite a good idea, but sorry, no. It's not possible. We are only 3 people in our department. We have to maintain and support more than 1,000 virtual servers in OpenVZ virtual servers. And sorry, good idea, but not possible. That was the problem in the past. So everyone was frustrated, because the operation guys were frustrated because they have to maintain so many virtual servers. We are frustrated because we cannot try something new technology. We had our strict development and deploy core set. We only can use, for example, a simple Ubuntu server with our Tomcat upon it. It was maintained by the operations. So when we want to change the configuration, we have to write an email to the operation guys. Please set the value from 1 to 2. Then hopefully we got back an email and say, okay, tomorrow or maybe next week. We do not have time yet. So everyone was frustrated. we had a high manual effort in the past. So in short, for example, how we deployed in the past. The guy, the developer, built his package, his WAR file, then he get this file, upload it to the FTP server, then he goes to the email client, write an email to the operation. The operation hopefully sends back an acknowledge, okay, I will install it. Then you have to inform your customer the new software will be installed tomorrow morning, hopefully. And this was the work, the daily work, so no automation process or manual automation process. That's the problem. But we will talk about the way out of this plight. So, next slide, the way.
Sorry? Yeah, the way. So, maybe it's interesting for you to hear how we reach the point or how we get to the point where we are today. So we are working definitely differently today, much differently. And as Alexander already said, we have to rethink our work. So the main goal that we would like to achieve in the past was that we just reduce the time that we need to just get a deployment or a new software code out and running. It's something that sounds very normal today, but that's a goal that is hard to achieve if you are coming from a semi-automated or a manual automated environment where you have to put in a lot of effort that the developer put the WAR file on the server and so on, then it's a large or a huge way or a huge step that you can go on the next level. The second thing was that we would like to gain flexibility. So what we would like to achieve was that the developer have the opportunity to just install or use software that is already available as container, because that makes life much easier. They can just try out Elasticsearch, for example, or they go with Prometheus, for another example, for monitoring. They put in different clustering technologies and so on, and we already made a lot of failures on the way, but nevertheless, this was the main goal that we would like to achieve. And what we also would be like care about is that we change our way we communicate together and we work together. So not only on the technology we would like to make a change, but we also would like to achieve another communication. definitely, we won't just relabel as DevOps, because that's shit. Because that doesn't say anything. No one knows what is DevOps today. Is it a process? Is it only culture? Is it a new team? Is it a team consisting of the same people? It's just a word, and the word is at the moment used in a very high case. So we just come to the third challenge, tearing down the great wall. This was the first step we would like to achieve. So, as I told you before, we have the problem that the development department just created the software, threw it over the great wall. And on the other side, we took the software and took the package and put it on a server. There's a metaphor for it. For example, I would like, as operator, to get a tennis ball. Yeah? So I said to the colleagues from the development department, please throw me a tennis ball over the wall. Yeah? They throw me a ball over the wall, but it was a soccer ball. Because the information of the tennis in the tennis ball got lost, wasn't there anymore. So I got a soccer ball, just cut it into slices and made a black and white tennis ball out of it, so that it was we were able to deploy it on the server infrastructure. There are different reasons, in our opinion, and what we expected, or in our experience, that are driving this change. There are internal reasons for us. So like Alexander said before, you need a new software stack, for example. You would like to go from Tomcat to WordX. If you are developing in a Java environment, you would like to use Golang, I don't know, Elasticsearch and whatever. Then there are, of course, external reasons. The time to market reduced and the complexity from the software packages, from the monoliths, and put it in a more sliced way so that you can just update the components. You want definitely automation. And with automation, we mean, in our case, we are using GitLab. From the source, into the full deployment. So you can just put up the source and it goes into proactive deployment if you want it as developer. And the great positive of it is that you get it automatically documented. So every step that is made in the GitLab repository is a commit. Everything is tracked by the Git as such. So every change that we made in or that we make on software is tracked in the GitLab repository and is recoverable. And of course, the most important thing are the people, because in the end, it doesn't matter what you're doing. In the end, it's made by people. The software is made by people. The pipelines are programmed by people. The software you need for your customers are programmed by people. You need people who are on a pager duty or whatever. So without people, you cannot handle anything of this stuff, and you are definitely not able to tear down the wall. And in the challenge 4, Alexander will tell you something about the way we did it.
Yeah, how we started. So what was the problem in the past? The problem in the past was we had a new project, a new big operational project for our operational units. And the problem was the requirements. For example, the one requirement was we need fast full text search. One requirement was we need live reports of commercial data, for example. And the idea was to use agile development processes to fulfill the needs of the customers, that we can fastly deploy software and so on. And we do not have an automated development process. We do not have the correct infrastructure to run available technologies. It's the first time we used agile development. Before, we used the good old waterfall model. So there are several requirements we cannot fulfill, or we cannot work with it. So then we go to the operational guys and say, we have to change something. Yeah, and the problem was, we cannot change it once. We have to do it iteratively. And we started, for example, the first step, what we do, or what we have done, was to automate our deployment process. So we go to our old traditional monolith applications and want to try to automate the deployment. So we started in first with Jenkins. It's a good tool, but it's another tool we have to maintain, we have to support. And at this time, we use GitLab for our source as our source repository. And then we switched to the GitLab CI/CD pipelines because we liked the idea that everything is in one spot and we do not have to maintain another tool like Jenkins. So we love this tool. We love CI/CD pipelines in GitLab. We try to automate nowadays everything. We have CI/CD pipelines to create CI/CD pipelines for new software projects. So we started with a simple case to automate our deployment process. So at a short overview, we compiled our code to a WAR package. We open an SSH channel to our OpenVZ servers. We upload the WAR package file, and we restarted the server. So a simple case, but the first automated process was born. Every software engineer in our company was excited because he do not have to do this manual stuff or dummy effort to do this. So that was the first step. The second step was more challenging. The second step was to change our infrastructure. So the first idea was, or the first challenge was, do we use Kubernetes? Do we use Docker? But at this stage, we were at the beginning, and we say, no, Kubernetes is too complex. Let's start with Docker Swarm, as we did nowadays. As Mario said before, we have approximately 150 stacks with 400 services and 1,800 or more than 1,800 instances. And that was really challenging because in the first time when we deploy, or the operation said, okay, we have the first version of our on-premises Docker Swarm cluster available. We tried it out, so we were excited. We read many articles and we tried it. So, but then, more or less, the failures come, the setbacks come, and this was also interesting for us to learn. It welded us together because we have to make short, very short iterations to talk about things. And at this time, when we tried it out, we do not use microservices. We tried to put, or we tried to take our old traditional monoliths and want to use the new flexible infrastructure because we have old treasures. We have to maintain this software. We cannot begin at the green grass or something like that. Yeah, and there are some nice stories. We, for example, we tried to introduce a new cache cluster. So we used, I think, Apache Ignite, for example. And the problem was, okay, each service in the Docker Swarm have to find each other or each instance. So we used multicast, normal approach, okay. It worked for two instances. Then we used three instances, four instances, five instances, and then the whole Docker Swarm stack with these instances broke up. So we do not know why. Because why? At five instances. So we have talked, we have tried how was the problem or where was the problem, but we didn't find out it in our code, so it seems to be correct. Then we have this short iteration with the operation guys, and we talked about this and about the behavior, and then the operation guy said, yeah, multicast, this doesn't work in the Docker Swarm network. And we, why? Because, yeah, in the Docker Swarm network, there is a super feature. There is one IP address in this overlay network, which make a left-right switch through all instances. So the problem was simple. So for example, one we catch up this IP address, and then the one instance want to talk to another and say, hey, I'm Alex. OK, I'm Mario. OK, I know you are Mario. And the next time I want to call Mario, hey, Mario. Mario said, I'm not Mario. I'm Bernie, for example. And that was the problem. So each node thinks I'm corrupted. I shut down. And therefore, the whole cluster broke up. So this was one setback, for example. Another setback was, for example, we at the beginning, we have no restrictions at our instances. So every instance can use everything he gets from the Docker host node. So we have jobs which are running or which use many, many CPU time. And with no restrictions, one instance get all CPU time and the others, yeah, the performance went down, for example. Yeah. And another example, for example, we want to try to introduce health checks, for example. It's a common use in the Docker Swarm network that I catch up an instance, is it healthy or not? We introduced it like, for example, like the microprofile node says, for example, we make a call to our service with, for example, in a path health check. And then we say, OK, the service is up. Then we make performance tests, for example, and we followed the network with many, many, many requests. Then at some time, the instance said, stop, I'm full. And that was the problem. The work went on. But when the Docker Swarm node, host node, comes, he wants to try the health check. And the health check said, oh, I do not catch up new requests. So you have to wait. And then the Docker Swarm cluster shut down the service and everything broke up again. So these are the daily life what we have. Then the next is the daily life. Yeah. What we have to do in daily life is we make monthly iterations to talk about the whole environment because we have to keep on rolling about this. Yeah. We make internal workshops about new technologies, for example, about new culture changes, how we want to work together, how we communicate together, for example. We more or less improve our CI/CD process. Nowadays, we have one file to rule them all. So we have one file in GitLab, which is responsible for each automated deploy process. for example, and the daily life is also to increase the motivation with the employee, but this comes with the automation, for example. So we save lifetime for developers. They have time to code and not use this time to write emails, for example. Yeah, we also try to continuous exchange between each developer, because we also have to standardize concepts, because there are so many tools to solve problems, and we do not want that, for example, the another guy use Nginx, the another guy use Traffic, the another guy use, for example, Apache or what else. So we also have to standardize things, but everyone can contribute, so we make continuous exchanges, we make meetings to talk about this. Yeah, but the thing is, everyone can contribute. So every guy, not every guy, but more or less the most of them are motivated to contribute.
Okay, the next challenge we have today is that we have to use clouds. It's just simple, because if you like clouds, it's okay that you will start on your own, but sometimes you have to use clouds, because there are services out there that makes life much more easier. For example, you have to step into databases that you cannot manage on your own, because you don't have the knowledge about it, and therefore one of the reasons that we, or one of the challenges that we are expecting today, is simple, that we have to use clouds in the last year. We are providing a full stack source, from source deployment, from the source until to the deployment, as I said before. But it's really complicated, and for us it is a challenge how you are able to work in an environment like we have. So we have an on-premises Docker cluster, for example, but we have also to use the Azure cloud, and in parallel the AWS cloud, and in parallel we also use some Google services, because every cloud has their benefits and also their drawbacks, but you have to use the tools that are out there on the market to just speed up your time to market, to can use the services and so on. So today we are at the point that we are really, I think, good at the on-premises environment, but we have to extend our knowledge about how we can use our on-premises infrastructure to also make use of the clouds, and to also make use of the cloud's features. The next thing that we need is that we bring up the continuous changes in the cloud. So at the moment we are using, as Alexander said before, GitLab to make GitOps in the core feature. So we have to also extend our GitLab to be able to deploy to the cloud. This includes, for example, playbooks to fire up the hosts in the clouds, in multiple clouds, to deploy new services there and to get new features up and running in this environment. And I think I just skipped a slide. Yeah. About the life, so I would like to...
Yeah, the life. When you introduce automation or introduce new culture, it does not stop. So the life is that you have to care about it. We make, for example, monthly workshops or meetups on a monthly basis to talk about the new infrastructure. And yeah, we more or less improve our CI/CD process and so on. And yeah, I think
that's it. As someone was asking about failure culture before and how to do postmortems, I think there was one of in the audience. Yes, that's our current challenge number 6 in the life part: failure culture. This is a famous poem from Goethe. I think most of you will know it from school or somewhere else. And usually the case is that at school, and we are trained for it, that we are counting the mistakes, we are counting the failures. So like in this example, I put in For mistakes, hopefully I've copied the poem from Wikipedia, if there are more mistakes that not mine. So I put in four mistakes, and in Austria the worst mark you can get is a 5, in German a 6 is a 6. So you are just getting a bad mark on this poem because you make four mistakes. But the interesting point of it is that this poem, or this cut from the two phrases of this poem, have 58 words. So there are 58 words written in this poem which are fully correct. They're correctly written and all. And so the failure quote of your four mistakes you made are 7%. The other way around, the stuff that is correct and that is working perfectly and that you have working written really good, is that you have correct word count of 93%. So in our culture, I would like to say, we are focusing too much about the errors and the failures as such. So what we would like to achieve is the next challenge that I will present you is that we are able to change the way we think about failures, so that failures are not only people-driven. If you like to get a template how you can do postmortems in real life, so if you need an red line how you can set up a postmortem meeting, just take, I think the colleague from GitLab is there in the audience, yes, I see him. GitLab has a really cool template file for how you can do postmortems, for example, and that's a really good way to just get out the most of the information that you are getting with your errors, because they have also a value. Failures have a value because you did something that doesn't work, but that's also an asset because this way won't work. So if you get it, then you have the possibility to learn from it and to get back some information. So even if you make a mistake, just go on, make a postmortem. Challenge number 7, postmortems everywhere. So what we try to achieve is that we make postmortems meetings. We should do it much more often, of course, because there are always mistakes and there are always things going wrong or that doesn't work the way we like it, for example. But we try to do as much postmortems as possible. In these meetings, we try to, we surely try to not focus on the people, maybe, who did the mistake. So we just try to bring out the system, where the system was broken, where something got the wrong way, where we can just put out a monitoring, where we can just learn from it, and so on. And one of the GitLab things, or that GitLab introduces in the postmortems, is the strategy of the 5 whys. Anyone knows about the 5 whys? Okay, the GitLab colleague knows about it. Yeah. The 5 whys is a simple method to get to the core of an issue. So you just ask, why was this happening? And maybe the first answer is because something did a mistake. And then you cover on and say, okay, why he did the mistake? Because maybe he haven't the information that, on the other hand, was another process running. And then you can ask, why was the information there? Because you can say, okay, we have no monitoring that is covering more of the system, so that the guy or the people who was executing the change wasn't aware that there is a problem. And you can go on over the steps, and at the end, when you make the same thing for why you make postmortems, why you make it, you came to the point, or we came to the point, because to use the potential of failures, because also, as I said before, failures have potential because they have a value and they are assets and you can learn from them. And you can easily, or relatively easily, can use all of the information from the people who work on an issue to put them together in a room and just find out what is the key feature, what is the key of this or the key problem of this postmortem.
So the future challenge for us, okay, is to gain more people for the culture change. So it we got not all people yet to make the culture change. So then another challenge would be to care for the culture, that should not be underestimated. So it is not the case that when you introduce it, it's over and it all running good. So you have to care about it. This is also, and we still have technology catch up in some parts of our software stack. And as the picture said, for some people, you have to drive back to the past, catch up the guys, and put it in the car and bring it the guy back to the future. So, but another thing is, do not rebuild the wall just by using other words for wall.
Exactly, and that's where this challenge came in. In our opinion, DevOps and the problem within. From there are several tweets on Twitter from different people, but I have picked out two. One is from Uwe Friedrichsen. I think he's quite well known in the community. And what he says is that the DevOps wording, yeah, has been buried either under tool-fixated continuous delivery discussions. That's definitely true in our opinion, because everyone is talking about DevOps tools and DevOps workspaces and DevOps I don't know whatever. But it's not the core of DevOps as such, because in our opinion, DevOps means that we have to change our culture, we work together, and we just try to fix the problems. So that's definitely true. And the second one I picked up is, we replaced one wall of confusion with another. In our opinion, that's also true, because it's definitely a huge benefit if you can choose from a lot of different tools which probably are doing or try to save the same problem, but it's also hard to achieve for the people, because if you look at the CNCF landscape, yeah, then you have, for example, 6 or 8 tools alone for proxies, then you have 6 tools for service meshes, then you have, I don't know, 10 possible tools for another task, and so on and so on. And normally the developer should care about the about developing, and it's a little bit of a problem, because you don't know which tool would solve your problem as best as it can. So you have to try it out, you have to put in a lot of effort to just test the tools to find out where are the small pieces and stuff where you can just get out the best of the tools. Yeah, that's one of the fewer challenges, and the 9th one, we have 10, so don't panic, coffee time is soon. Challenge number 9, Epursi Morve. I think a lot of you know about it, Galileo Galilei, who is defending his picture of the world. So don't give up if it doesn't work in the first time. So we also have to just rearrange our targets and rearrange our way we work together, because we tried out X and come to another example, then this won't work too, then we tried it again, we just changed, of course, our tooling, like how we are doing the postmortems, then we tried this and we tried that. And one thing we would like to give you is that you have to be patient, and you and don't be scared if something doesn't work at the first moment, because you just have to try it and to find out, like Björn said before, what is working for you and what is working in your environment and what is working for your company and what is working for your teams and for the guys you are working with.
And challenge number 10, yeah. Some people have to be moved. Yeah, it's difficult, it's complex, because there comes a time where you meet people who will not like to change things because they are working several years with the same software stack, and they do not want to move because they are afraid of it. And sometimes you have to force people to leave their comfort zone, for example. Like my example, I'm yet at this conference, my first talk, so I leave my comfort zone as software engineer. And what we got from our company, or what we have seen, is that some people have tried to come out from their comfort zone, they do not want to miss the old life. The key factor about this was that we tried to introduce a new culture change backed up with automation. So we give it as a whole package that makes it easier, for example, for people to change. Yeah.
Then we have an additional extra challenge that we faced during our traveling here to the conference yesterday. As Roland said before in the introduction from our talk, we have missed one guy who has been with us because we have to change our flights, but we would like to honor him because he cannot be here today. He would be sitting in the audience. And why we do this? Because we think that people matter, definitely. So what you are working with technology or what you are working at your company and what you are inventing with technology is a cool thing, of course, but people matter. And yeah, to come to the end of the talk, we would like to say thank you. Hopefully there was something inside. If you are interested to talk with us, we are backstage then, and we can talk about some technical details if you want, and if there are any questions, then we can also put it in on the stage now.
I think we have still time for one question or two. Are there any questions?
Ha.
There's one over there. One
second. Well, it's actually two questions. how did you convince your management to get this way? And the second, who was the magician who pulled you, who made the change, who was the first one to bring the idea to you all?
For the first question, we did it bottom up, fully bottom up, so we just have no management attention in beforehand, so we just put it bottom up because we are the guys who have the experience in our environment, what the people, the colleagues, and also our customers are in need of. So we have seen or have recognized that we have to change the way we work and the way which tools we are providing in our company, so that we can put in or that we can get more out of it. That's for the first. And for the second, Peter was one of the guys who have invented this change several years ago, because we knew Peter since 10 years, as we started with our Tomcat development in the Strabag, of course. Yeah. And he also knew that we are using containers since 2006, for example, where containers were not sexy back then. but he also told us about Docker, of course, in 2013 and so on, and we stay connected. And he always told us what is going on, and so we have a connection, and we put always in the efforts to just find out if it works for us. This didn't work for us back then, and then we tried it once again a year later, and so on and so on. So we just talk together and just share our thoughts, and that's the whole magic. You have to talk with the people, like with you, and in the backstage then, and to find out where are the ideas coming from. It's that simple.
Yeah, and we started with one team, my team and the operation guys, and it was quite easy because we have a new project, we have new requirements, and to fulfill these requirements we have to make a technical change. So this was also one case. Yeah.
Yeah.
So a small group out of more developers started this, and then it overflooded the others, more or less.
Okay, thank you.
Many thanks, Amy, for your coming.